everyone, and welcome to this talk, which is an introduction to remote data science. My name is Andrew Trask, and in the next few minutes, we're going to be walking through three main steps. So first, we're going to talk about motivations for remote data science. So first, is going to be some motivation for remote data science. We're going to see a little bit about how it works, and we're going to finish by talking about a new opportunity for you to learn more about this exciting technology. So first, let's talk a little about the motivations. First setup for this is really about how, you know, our ability in society to answer important questions is limited by the amount of data that we have access to, because that data simply is not at our disposal. It's in another country or another department. And this leads us to kind of the core premise of this talk, which is that solutions to really important problems already exist, but we just can't access those solutions because we can't access the training data and the machine learning data that we need to be able to solve them. So there's a wide variety of examples that are like this, but we're going to drill down into just a couple. So first one we're going to talk about is breast cancer. Unfortunately, around 1 in 8 women encounter breast cancer at some point in their lives around the world. And this leads to as much as 700,000 deaths per year from breast cancer. And one of the main contributing factors to this death rate is that we have a really difficult time detecting it. Meaning when you go in for a mammogram and a radiologist takes a look at the scan, many places have as high as a 1 in 4 false negative rate. Meaning that 1 in 4 women who go in who have cancer are told that they have a clean bill of health. Then they wait 2 more years before they have another scan and the cancer is really advanced by the time they find out about it. Breast cancer classification should be a relatively straightforward image classification problem, which deep learning and machine learning is really good at. But unfortunately, machine learning models, even the best ones that are put into production, are even worse than typical human-based screening programs with a 1 in 3 false positive and false negative rate being common. And this is because, this is my opinion, that the largest data set that we have to work with is only 3 million images. And in deep learning and machine learning communities, we know that this is not a very large data set. And this is despite the fact that around 8 billion images have been produced in the last 10 years alone. So we have this huge latent resource of images to work with, but we're only working with tiny slices of it. And as a result, machine learning models are not actually solving this problem, despite the fact that they probably could. So this brings us back to our general theme of how solutions exist to important problems, but access to data for those solutions is limited. And I want to talk about one more use case real quick before we talk about the actual technology. This use case comes from the United Nations Privacy Enhanced Technology Lab, or the PET Lab, which is a new body that is piloting a lot of the technologies you're going to talk about today. Specifically, they're looking at a trade-related use case. So you may not be familiar, but Canada and the United States, for example, each measure the amount of goods that are going over the Canadian-US border. But often these things don't match. So usually they match just like they do here, but sometimes goods can disappear, right? Where Canada has record of goods that are supposedly going to the United States, but the United States doesn't have any record of having received them. It turns out this is a really important thing for nations to be able to measure. And so the new UN PET Lab project is working with 5 different UN member nations to be able to collaborate together on their shared data resources to understand how goods are flowing without having to centralize those data assets into one location, right? And again, this is all just about the same core premise where there are solutions to really important problems that already are exist, right? In theory, but access to the data necessary for those solutions is too limited for us to accomplish them. Now, in this talk so far, you might be wondering, why not just centralize the data? Why not just put all the data in one place that you need for, say, breast cancer or monitoring global trade to solve these really important problems? And there's a host of different reasons that we could consider why this might be the case. But I want to focus on one that is simply too inconvenient. And just anecdotally, if you wanted to solve this breast cancer classification problem that I mentioned, and you were going to acquire data from 1,000 different hospitals, that's 1,000 different institutions that you have to get on the phone with, that you have to talk to their legal department, they have to talk to your legal department, you have to go back and forth and back and forth, and you have to manage the risk, and they're going to ask, where are you going to put the data? And like, who are you? Things like background checks. And it's just such an enormously complex and time-consuming challenge that it's just intractable. Even if you have lots of money and willpower, no one has overcome this challenge thus far. And this reminds me of how sort of public data used to be, in the sense of, before the internet, if you wanted to know about a business or prices, or you wanted to order airline tickets, you had to get on the phone, right? You had to actually call a business and talk to a real person and ask them. And today, the private data industry is still a lot like that. And what we're going to be talking about in the next few minutes is really the same solution to kind of the same problem, which is we should be able to take private data, put it into a server, and other people should be able to answer questions using that data without us having to be involved as data owners at all. Inversely, as a data scientist, I should be able to just access the ability to answer questions using important data in the same level of ease that I currently access the internet. So this is the field of remote data science. And this is really what remote data science is all about. So when you have an organization that has data, you have a data scientist who wants to be able to work with it, and they remotely access this server to answer their question instead of downloading the data set itself. And this isn't all about data scientists accessing individual institutions. This is actually about data scientists accessing a whole internet of data that is sensitive and private that they never actually obtain a copy of, but they can still use to answer important questions. So in the next few minutes, now I want to transition to how this technology actually works. And this is going to be a very short sample of what this technology is actually like. And if you sort of like what you see and want to learn more, then you can check out the education resources that we'll talk about at the end of this talk. So this is going to come from a library called PySift. And PySift allows you to sort of have the additional functionality in partnership with tools like PyTorch to be able to study data that's located at different machines. So let's start at the top with a simple experiment where we're going to locate data and do a little data science project. So I import SIFT. First thing I need to do is source a network. So a network is just a registry of where private data assets exist. Think of it like sort of Google search, but for private data instead of public. So I pick a registry, I connect to that registry, and inside of that registry are what's called domains. So domains, much like a website domain, are just different servers that exist on the internet that are holding private data, right? So let's say I choose two of these domains, and now I get a variable, so we'll say Canada and the United States, that allows me to talk to those domains, right? And to be able to interact with them. So I connect to both of these domains, and this brings us to sort of the analysis. So now I've got access to data in Canada, and I've got access to data in the United States, right? So two different locations. So the first thing I need to do is figure out what my privacy budget is. And a privacy budget is the limitation on the amount of information that I'm going to be able to pull out of these servers automatically. So it looks like I've got 200 epsilon of privacy budget from Canada, and I've got 200 epsilon of privacy budget from the United States sort of to work with, right? And if I run out of privacy budget, I can't pull any more data out. I can't pull any more sort of information out. That's what keeps the data safe. So I'm going to select a couple data sets. So see how the data sets would allow me to list them. I'm going to select number 32. Looks like we've got, you know, the amount of imports and exports of dairy that the United States knows about to Canada and Canada to the United States. Inversely, we have the same going the other direction. And now that I've got these two data sets, or I've got pointers to these two data sets, variables that are pointing to data in two different countries, right? Now I'm going to do an analytic. So I've got this pointer on the left, USA exports to Canada. I've got the pointer on the right, Canada imports from USA. These are each pointing to tensors that are in different servers on different parts of the world. It should be impossible for me to subtract them by each other, right? The data is on two different machines. But what happens right here behind the scenes is it just secure MPC shares using an input privacy technique called secure multi-party computation. And this returns to me a pointer to these encrypted shares at both locations, right? This means that I perform this subtraction, but no data has actually left either institution. Instead, an encrypted protocol was used to be able to actually calculate the result and maintain the result in an encrypted state with shares at each of these locations. And finally, in order for me to download the result, what I need to do is add some differential privacy noise to the result so that the automatic privacy budgeting accounting mechanism goes, so you had 200 privacy budget left, so you just add this amount of noise. Looks like I can let you download this result, right? And I even have a little bit of privacy budget left over. And what I hope you see in this sort of end-to-end flow is that sort of in the span of one notebook, I can go out on the internet, look for some data, find some data, perform computation against that data, even if it's you know, data located on different machines, and then download my result without having to get on the phone with anybody, without having to, you know, do data partnerships, and most importantly, without having to actually download a copy of the data set. And if you'd like to learn more about this, I'm super excited to announce that with the generous support of PyTorch, the OpenMind community is releasing today a brand new course teaching you how to participate with these types of technologies. Both how to deploy data into a server and advertise it on these types of networks, as well as how to participate as a data scientist. And this will all prepare you for a forthcoming United Nations certification on remote data science. So to check out these courses, please go to courses.openmind.org, where you can register for free, just like 8,000 other people already have. Thank you so much for your time and attention, and I hope you have a great PyTorch Dev Day.